swag trapping, imagine talking. Take it to get to keep it in rap and talking. They rapping walls and get embarrassed, it actually happens often. You must sound like a laugh. So pretty much usually what I do, man, is I start with black. First the gray, and then come in with black. And what that does, boy, it brings out the cracks, like the wrinkles and shit.
Right.
And then pretty much once I lay down the black, then I start doing the green. And then pretty much with the green, I just try to go really soft so it doesn't go in the cracks. So whenever you look at it, you see that depth in it. So my uncle always told me, man, like never always have something to do. Cause the moment that you don't have something to do is like the moment that you start doing bad, you know? Start fucking up.
Yeah.
Start doing shit that you're not supposed to. So that kinda always stuck with me, and I went to Walmart to try to see if I can find something to build. Cause you know how you can always build shit, like little models?
Yeah, little cars and shit.
Yeah, so that's what I was looking for, man. I wanted to, like, something to burn some time and just to forget, dude. Try to get into shit. And they didn't have anything, dude. They didn't have anything at Walmart that I could use. So, I don't know, man. I went to, it was towards, like, probably like a month before Halloween. So I ended up going towards the fucking Halloween aisle. And then out of nowhere, I was just kind of telling myself, well, maybe I can do this, you know, like, and, like, buy the fake skin and buy the fucking torn shit.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing was, is whenever I tried to buy the stuff, it was too expensive, dude. Like, for like, the rips, the little small rips are, like, 20 bucks. And the thing about it is, when you buy them, you got to make sure you don't fuck it up.
Mm-hmm.
So I just told myself, instead of doing that, I'll just make my own. The Grinch, I start bringing it out a little bit more towards Christmas as well. Mainly more towards Christmas, just because it's, you know, that's when the movie was released for a Christmas thing, you know?
Yeah.
I do bring it out on Halloween, but it's, you know, not as much. Yeah, so pretty much now that it's laying down, the greens and the blacks kind of mix. And it gives it that dark kind of green that you want for the Grinch. At first, when I first started, dude, I would fuck it up. It's just, I didn't know what I was doing. I would try to sit there and just do the green and the black, and then pretty much it would just take too long. And then one day I just painted it all black, and I just kind of rushed it.
Mm-hmm.
And when I rushed it, it just came out so, like, natural. Because the thing about it is, like, I'm not really trying to get the most of it. I just want to do it as fast as I can, because whenever you take your time for it, it's just, you try to perfect it too much, and then when you look at it, it just doesn't look natural. I'm super perfectionist, dude, and then a lot of the time when I would look at it, it just didn't look real. I just be like, damn, I just spent too much time on it. Yeah, that's tight, because, like, when I would wear it to work, it was funny, because I would tattoo with it, and one day I said, fuck it, you know, instead of, like, taking it off, I decided to go to the club with it,
mm-hmm.
And, dude, that shit was the craziest night.
Yeah.
It was so tight, like, so, yeah, that's what I noticed, like, whenever you just kind of rush it, it just comes out a lot more natural, and then, yeah, that's it. Yeah, I actually got this from Morph Store. Super well known. Cool. That's pretty much it.
You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch. You really are a heel. You're as cuddly as a cactus. You're as charming as an eel, Mr. Grinch. You're a bad banana with a greasy black peel. You're a monster, Mr. Grinch. Your heart's an empty hole. Your brain is full of spiders. You've got garlic in your soul, Mr. Grinch. I wouldn't touch you with a 39 and a half foot pole.
My name is Ivan. A lot of people call me Stacks, but
Mainly just because, like, I'm more of, like, Minecraft, kind of Lego stacking stuff, you know, not money stacks, but just item stacks. I was born in Los Angeles. Grew up in the San Fernando Valley, 818. And then at the age of 13, I moved to Texas due to violence and a lot of just gang. One of my brother's best friends got killed at the age of 13, like down the street from us. So my mom just kind of packed up and we moved. We didn't even know. So and the way that I got into tattooing is through my brother. I used to watch him tattoo people in the garage. And one day, before when I was in college, I actually see him get a job at a tattoo shop, and he was actually getting paid for what he did. And it just motivated me to want to do it. So right up there, I ended up saving my checks from from Taco Bell. And then on my check, I bought a tattoo machine. I quit my job, broke up with my ex and with my current girlfriend to like dedicate myself to tattooing. I started at a young age. I got my first tattoo at 13. And then pretty much I started tattooing probably like around 16, 17. But pretty much I was just messing my legs up, fucking my tattoos up, because I started practicing on myself. The first actual tattoo that I did actually wasn't on myself. It was on a girl that I was dating in college. She knew that I knew how to draw really good. She knew that my brother was a tattoo artist, so she kind of convinced me to borrow my brother's machines and do some stars. And I fucked the shit up. I fucked the tattoo up pretty bad. It was supposed to be like simple. It was crazy. It was supposed to be a simple stars and shit, and I just blew out everything. Stars were ugly. So the next day, I called her, and you know, we were dating, and I was like, hey babe, like, how you been? And then she was like, I got bad news. And I was like, well, what do you mean bad news? And that was like the day after the tattoo. And she was like, yeah, I was doing something on top of the stairs. And she was kind of reaching over, and her mom seen the tattoo, and she seen, and it was fucking bad. And she pretty much told me that her mom didn't want me to ever talk to her or speak to her. And I told her, so, and for me, I was just like, bet, you know, all we gotta do is sneak around. Right. So I was telling her, all right, bet, so I guess I'll see you later. And she was like, no, you don't understand, I can't ever talk to you. And I was like, so like not even sneaking around. And she was like, no, at all, like can't even talk to you at all. And I was like, damn. So yeah, she broke up with me after that. Fucked the shit up. Pretty so much
why do you wear the pink hair?
So pretty much the pink that's under me, I pretty much wear it from my mom. My mom was she was diagnosed with a breast cancer about 4 years ago. We're going on 5 now. And it was just a hard time in my life. You know, you see your mom every day, you love your mom, and then to find out, you know, she has cancer. And it was just sad because the family, well, we went through a lot. And my hair has been changing throughout the years, and pink was always gonna be the last color because I had to kind of earn it. My mom ended up getting a double vasectomy, which means she removed both her breasts. And the thing was, is she had an option to either remove the breast, remove the cancer, or remove both the breasts, and she chose to do both. And she was with four other women, and only one did the same thing that my mom did, which was remove both the breasts. And the other two ladies, one chose to remove the cancer and one chose to just remove one breast. And it was sad because like a year later, my mom was going back, and she found out that the two ladies that didn't do it, the cancer came back. Yeah. And it was sad. It was like, it really hurt me because like, even though my mom was like lucky, like, you know, she did it, you know, like it still hurt because like at the end of the day, I feel the other person's pain. I felt like even though I was happy that my mom was good, I was torn because like, I could imagine their pain, you know, like finding out that their mother's cancer. Because to me, the way that I look at it, every mom is my mom now. Yeah. You know, ever since that. My hair color first started changing when she was diagnosed. I went to blonde. I was blonde at first. Bleached my hair, and blonde pretty much for me was like a blank piece of paper. It was like a clean slate. And And from there, I went to Red. Red was the first year. It was anger, frustration, more towards hatred towards the world. So I did Red for quite a while. The second year was I did Green. Green was more of confusion, not knowing what was gonna happen, like, you know, just lost. And then the third color the fourth color that I did was yellow. Yellow was when we were finding out that the cancer was gone, and yellow was more of happiness. Yellow was like sunshine, and I made myself do yellow because the way that I always looked at it, if I see yellow, it's gonna make me think positive. So I did yellow for quite a while, and you know, now that my mom is clear, and you know, she's not fully clear, but we're still going back. But now that everything's getting better, my mom's healthier, my mom's more like interactive, I was like, I finally felt like I finally earned the color pink. And it wasn't until 2 months ago that I finally did pink, and it just took a lot out of me, because for me, like, pink for a guy, it's a very girly color, and for me, the way I looked at it, it was just real hard for me to just do it. And for me, I felt like I had to kind of earn it. I felt I had to feel it, and like now, like that I'm pink, I'm actually happy, because like for me, the way I look at it is, you know, we're gonna, like, even though my mom, like, we never know if the cancer's gonna come back, we know that we're gonna be strong, that, you know, I'm there for my mom no matter what. So that's what the pink is for.
That's deep. Yeah. Okay. So you say
pretty much I started doing graffiti that's what I started off. I started drawing. I started doing graffiti, and then I actually stopped doing graffiti. I don't do graffiti no more. I actually ended up getting caught tagging a school. And I went to jail for it and everything, and I ended up getting charged with a felony, but I was lucky enough to beat it. So I stopped doing graffiti altogether, and I just started drawing and painting. So that's what I mainly do, and I started mainly in school. I just couldn't pay attention in school, and all I wanted to do was draw. I've actually asked myself that question a couple of times, what do I see myself doing for the rest of my life. And you know, it's crazy, I feel like I'm gonna be tattooing no matter what for the rest of my life. Like, I just love tattooing, and I just feel like I want to be touching everything, like painting. I recently just got into like special effects makeup. It's just so much that I just feel like I just want to do everything and anything that I can. I travel a lot, so that's the good thing. You know, I love to travel. Traveling is like something that I do. The biggest thing that I'd like to do is travel and tattoo in new places. So for me, like, when I tattoo in a new state or a new city, it just brings me, like, it just makes me like really feel good. There's times where I tattoo and the view is just so fucking phenomenal. It just makes everything worth it, you know. That's a good thing. I've counted it once, and I should be like up in the probably like close to 200 tattoos. I have about 200 tattoos. I used to have my sleeves tattooed. Yeah, I used to have my sleeves, and then I used to have my whole head tattooed, and I met a doctor and I got that lasered off. So pretty much I lost tattoos. Yeah. So yeah, pretty much I have my whole body, have my whole back, my legs. I just have a couple empty spots, so something I'm going forward to. Started tattooing my face recently too. So that's, I wish I would have done that sooner. I got my first tattoo when I was 13. Actually got it from my brother. It was a homemade machine that we both made. We actually burnt out the house. We didn't burn the house down, but we just burnt the electricity down like that. All the electricity went out because we didn't do the plugs right.
And switches and shit.
Yeah, it was fucking nuts. And then pretty much I got tattooed on the floor. Next to the window, and we did it next to the window, so the moment that my parents would pull up, we would just stop tattooing, and they pulled up. Yeah.
Okay.
The craziest tattoo that I've done, I tattooed some guy's dick.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. It was weird. It was cool at first, because I came to work one day, and I knew something was up, man. I came in, and everybody's being nice. Everybody's like, hey, Ivan's here. And we have a guy that's been tattooing for like 17 years, and he's real stuck up. He's the one that like, oh, I'm better than everybody. So I showed up, and he was telling me that he didn't tattoo. He was saying that he never tattooed. So I was looking at him, I was like, damn, something's up. So there's a Indian guy, and he takes me to the back, and I'm kind of trying to figure out what's going on.
Yeah.
And when he takes me to the back, he drops his pants, and I'm like, whoa, what the fuck, what's going on? And I tell him, hey, bro, you need to chill. You need to pull your pants up. Like, you know, that's not how we do stuff. And he was like, but the tattoo is, I need it down here. And he was like, oh, I don't care about that. You need to explain it. And, yeah, he kept explaining, but I couldn't understand him. So I finally was like, all right, let me look at it. So he dropped his pants, and he had this, it's not a disease. It's just he was born with it. It's called vitiligo. And vitiligo is pretty much whenever you have either dark skin and you're born with white pigments. And the thing about it, unfortunately for him, the vitiligo was only on his dick. So pretty much his dick was all brown with very big white spots all over it. Yeah. So he was telling me that he was having a bad sex life all his life because girls would always think it was a sexual transmitted disease.
Yeah.
So I told him, you know, like man to man, I was like, I can help you. Like, I could fix this because, you know, I'm really, like, I was good with pigments and recoloring pigments. So the first session, I hit him with the biggest needle, 23 mag. That's a really big, wide needle. It's like the widest. Well, we have wider ones, but that's by far the widest one that I had. And yeah, I went to work. I started coloring his whole dick from the shaft all the way to the tip, dark brown. All the way under, all the way to the top, the base, behind the head. Like, it was crazy. And it healed right. And before he left, he was asking me for a piercing. And I was just like, oh, that's kind of weird. That's weird. Asked me for a piercing. I thought it was because of cosmetic. I'm helping him out. And sure enough, later on, when he came back for the second session, because you always got to do two sessions to really make sure that the color is really concentrated. So we did the second session. And during the second session, he was being really weird. He was telling, like, he was, like, while I was tattooing him, he was telling me how his girl would, like, kind of, like, give him oral sex. And I was just kind of looking at him, and I was like, hey, dude, you know, kind of keep it professional, dude. Like, I have your dick in my hand, mm-hmm. like, come on. And then he's like, I don't know, I just didn't know, I felt like he was being weird. And he started trying to ask me if he wanted to take me out to eat after the tattoo. And I was just like, bro, like, keep it professional, dude. So my boss walks over, and he's like, what's the problem? And the guy tells my boss, I'm trying to take your employee out to eat. And my boss is like, no, we don't do that here. Sorry, bro, we just don't. And he was like, come on, I just want to take your employee out to eat. And he's like, no, you can't. So my boss walks away, and he sits down. And my client, the client that I'm tattooing, he fucking tells me that he wants me to suck his dick. So I pretty much stopped tattooing. I put my tattoo machine, and I'm like, I'm done, like, so my boss comes over here, and before I tell him, I'm thinking either one, my boss is going to tell me, just finish the tattoo and get him out of here, and then I was going to quit my fucking job, or two, he was going to kick him out, and I was going to be happy, and my boss came over, and I told him that he pretty much told me that he wanted me to suck his dick, and my boss kicked him out. It was funny. That was the most uncomfortable tattoo, yeah. Weirdest.
Man, it's yeah. Really odd, bro.
Yeah. Dick tattoos, hard job being a tattoo artist.
That's crazy, bro.
Yeah. I just started tattooing, like, you know, little people, like, it wasn't, not like, nobody really famous, and then, like, little by little, people started coming to the shop, and it was just a little bit more and more. I tattooed, Houston, like, really knows the C&D scrap metal.
Yeah.
Which is everybody knows he pays in $2 bills.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one of my clients. That was one of my first clients. He actually has a $2 bill tattooed on him. He was super fucking nice. He's autographed my $2 bill, and he paid in $2 bills. Yeah, he got a tattoo and paid in $2 bills. Yeah, so he's super nice. And then I ended up tattooing a baseball pitcher from the Marlins. from Florida Marlins, and then I didn't get his name. The main reason we found out he was a baseball player was because when he was leaving in a black Range Rover,
yeah.
Brand new, black rims, like super nice, like, and we ended up Googling his name, and sure enough, he was a baseball player. And then I ended up tattooing from the Real House of Vancouver's. I ended up tattooing one of the girls from that show, and she was super nice. It was weird trying to sleep with me, but we got drunk. It was nice. And then it just started going up. It just started, like, different artists started hitting me up. It was just random. And I the next person that ended up hitting me up was a rapper. His name is Brick. He's from, like, the Wolfpack Records. He has, like, about, like, 87,000 followers. It's like, he ended up hitting me up, and I ended up going over to his house, tattooed him. It was a really nice experience. It was a rare opening. And then the next person that ended up hitting me up was John Tucker, which is a celebrity photographer. And that one caught me by surprise, because I've known of him, like, we've talked before, but he just never showed me love. Like, I just felt like we were just gonna be in the same room at the same time, you know. And one day he actually hit me up, and he wanted a tattoo by me, and I was kind of intrigued, because, you know, you have all these followers, you can hit up anybody for a tattoo, and he chose for me. And that was really helpful, because, like, you know, like, it's just an honor. So it's just been going from there. I've been, you know, tattooing from, like, you know, small people to, like, you know, people in the industry, you know. I didn't tattoo actually met a playmate. I wasn't able to tattoo her, but yeah, she was on the front cover for Playboy. Do not remember what year it was, but I knew she was hot. Yeah. Early in the morning, you know, I mean, I usually sleep in. If I do get a house call, I'll try to do a house call before I go into work. I'll go into work, and then by the time I get off, I like to party. I like to drink. You know, I like to go out to the bars. If for some reason somebody hits me up for a tattoo house call late at night, I'm always open, because, you know, you just can't stop working. You always got to get it. If not, what I usually try to do is I try to paint. I actually practice my special effects makeup, zombies. I just try to perfect it to where it gets a lot better. So it's been going really good. Honestly, the main thing that I want out of this tattoo industry is I don't want to be rich. I don't really care about money. It's whatever. To me, it's more about recognition. I want to be known for my tattoos. I want people to know, not just tattoos, because at the end of the day, I feel like if I'm just a tattoo artist, people just look at me like a commodity. Like they only want me for tattoos, and I don't want that. I want people to look at me as a human, and that I have different talents, that it's just not tattooing. It can be special effects makeup, it can be painting, drawing. I really do a lot of stuff. I do stuff people don't even know. I got college background. I'm certified for cranes. I can weld. People don't know that I'm pretty much certified, like, for plasma cutting. Like, I came from a construction field, so, like, people don't know that I can build stuff. I can read blueprints. I know everything about carpentry. Like, it's just stuff people don't know. I came from a family where, believe it or not, so I'm Hispanic, and I came from my dad and my mom were super strict. We weren't allowed to draw. We weren't allowed to do. We weren't allowed to paint. My dad would actually, well, my dad would beat us, because we're Mexicans, but I did deserve a lot of the beatings, so I can't be, like, an asshole and be like, oh, my parents beat me. But yeah, man, my dad and my mom, seeing drawing and drawing graffiti as not beneficial, they said that, you know, you're not gonna get paid for this, like, there's no future for this, you know, you need to stop drawing. My dad would always rip graffiti books. My parents did not like us tattooing. When my parents found out we were tattoo artists, they were just against it. They just were like, you're not gonna get anywhere. my parents are very against tattoos. Unfortunately, I started tattooing my face about 2 months ago, and my mom's just disappointed. I think that's the biggest letdown for her, is me tattooing my face. But now, I feel like my parents are finally like looking forward. Like they're seeing that I'm actually doing stuff positive. They see that that I'm not doing negative stuff. That I'm not doing bad. That I'm actually doing something beneficial. And I'm finally feeling like my parents are actually proud of me. A lot of the costumes, my mom actually helped me. The Grinch costume, my mom helped me with this. If it wasn't for her, I wouldn't be wearing this. She's the one that actually took me to Hobby Lobby and actually spent time to actually help me make this, you know. So she kind of went and beyond. And as of today, she helps me with a lot of my stuff. Whenever I got Jolly Ranchers, I had yellow hair. When I had yellow hair, I found out that yellow Jolly Ranchers are limited, that they're really rare to find. And I had yellow hair. So I couldn't find yellow Jolly Ranchers, so instead, me and my mom individually unwrapped every single Jolly Rancher. We spray painted it. Every single Jolly Rancher, we spray painted them yellow. And my mom was super nice enough to help me rewrap them and super glue them so I can take them to my hairdresser, April, to put them on me. So, yeah, man, like, it's crazy. My parents went from, like, not wanting me to be artistic to not, you know, being to like, hey, you need to read books, you need to study, you need to do something with your life, find a career, to like, now they help me, now they motivate me, now they see what I do, and they really like it. They really do. Like, it was my mom's birthday the other day, and I spent the whole day, my mom hired me to paint kids' faces for the whole time, and it was really nice, because like, my mom really like seen that, and she like really appreciated it, and all the family was loving it. Oh yeah, parents are really scared. They're scared to see their kids fail. So whenever they see their kids doing something that they love, or they see something that they love doing, and the parents will always automatically feel like that's not gonna take them anywhere. I had friends that, you know, they used to do into photography, and their parents would be like, "You're not gonna get anywhere because what is taking pictures gonna do?" And like now, they're photographers out there taking photos for like really high end people, you know. And the same thing goes for painters. You know, back in the day, people would be like, "Well, you're not gonna make it because, you know, painters are like a starving artist." And I have friends now, like Hostel, whose house is really beautifully decorated. He lives at home, doesn't work, and all he does is sell his paintings, you know. And it just comes to tell, like, at the end of the day, as long as you do what you love, you know, it's going to pay off. You know, it might not pay off in the first couple of years, but it's going to start paying off towards the end when you finally improve your craft. I only look up to one person. He's a very well-known tattoo artist in the industry. He's world-renowned. He might be, like, to me, I feel like he's one of the best. His name is Nico Furtuda. He's from California. Everything he does is so real. It's so raw. It's so full of like color, like so detailed. And that's what I look up to, because that's what I want to do. Like, I only like doing very high detail stuff. Like, the more detail, the better. And I feel like I'm shooting towards him because that's what I want to do. Like, I want to be able to one day get a photo, a realistic photo of a woman, or, you know, somebody's kid, somebody's wife, or, you know, if not something like, you know, a picture of some crazy demon or something realistic, and be able to be like, I got you, this is gonna look just like the photo. So that's what I look up to. Okay. Since I was born, we've been here more than 24 years. My mom is now a resident. She was able to, you know, she was able to take the exam and pass and get her residency. Same thing for my dad. It just comes to say, you know, like, my parents came from nothing. My dad, we had a talk the other day, and my dad, he bought me a sleeping mattress. So whenever I go camping, and my dad told me, "Look, son, I used to sleep in one of these for like years." And it just opened up, because when we were little, I remember when I was little, like when I was like 3 or 4, like, we didn't have anything. We were broke. We were like really poor, not poor, but we were just we're always struggling. We're always struggling because we had a family of three. So it just comes to show, like, you know, you can come to the United States, be an immigrant, have nothing, and still bring your family, you know, and persevere. My dad, you know, who I love to death because he raised me right. You know, even though I've had, you know, run-ins with the laws, you know, and I've been locked up and stuff, my dad has never been in jail. My dad has never stepped in jail. He has never been pulled over. My dad has never gotten a ticket since he's been here, and he's been here more than 24 years. So it just comes to show, you know, not all illegals are bad, you know. My parents came, and, you know, they're hardworking. They work every day. My mom's a bus driver. She's been driving school buses for almost 24 years. So, yeah.
So what do you have to say to Donald Trump?
Fuck Donald Trump. Yeah. Viva Mexico. To all the people in Mexico and who are in the cartel, let's end the violence. Let's stop kidnapping family, and let's just put peace to this, because having family kidnapped and missing and not knowing where they're ever gonna be, it just sucks. So, from experience, I've had two of my cousins that pretty much imagine if you had your cousin, your best cousin, the cousin you see every day, get kidnapped by the cartels. You know, that shit fucks you up. I've had two of my cousins that were pretty much were the same age. They got kidnapped. They held them for a ransom for about 2 months. And for those whole 2 months, they were tied to a chair. They couldn't do anything. They were just tied for 2 months. About 2 weeks, 2-3 weeks ago, they ended up kidnapping my aunt and my uncle. They're elderly. They're really old. You know, not being offensive. My uncle was going to treatment in Mexico for cancer, and they ended up picking him up. And they held him for ransom, and thank God they've returned him. But I've had family from my dad's side where we weren't as lucky. I have uncles that disappeared, and we just don't know. And it's been years. There's a family that it's been months that they've been gone. It's just not knowing sucks, so. To all those people in Mexico, let's stop the violence. Peace. So pretty much what I like to listen is, I like to listen to Selection. Selection, 258 Jameson is my favorite. It's just very soulful music. Like, that's what I really love. I like soulful music. I like very, like, music that calms you down. Second will probably be death metal. So I know, it's crazy. I like death metal, heavy metal for second. And the main reason is the drums and the guitar, something about that just I will always love. Next is gonna be reggaeton, and then country's under reggaeton, and then the last one's gonna be rap's in the bottom. Yeah. Like, you know, I'm a December baby, born in December 1st, so yeah, I like Christmas. I'm not a really jolly person, but I'll be happy when I'm at home, because, like, usually during Christmas, my mom wants me to dress up as the Grinch so she can take photos next to the tree and, like, post it on social media, rub it on people's faces, like, the Grinch came to my house. But it's really her son. I do a lot of tattoo parties. I've actually thrown a couple tattoo parties. The first one that I threw was at the Marriott. I know we're not supposed to be throwing parties at the Marriott. Sorry, Marriott. But here in Houston, there's a Marriott Marquis. And in the Marquis, it's not like any Marriott, you know, in LA or any Marriott, like, around the world. This Marriott has the view of downtown. And we have a Texas-sized pool. Like, it's in the figure of the Texas outline. And it has a lazy pool. So I've actually thrown about 3 parties there. I threw parties from their cheapest room to their suite, where that was the best one. Pretty much the best. It's just the best view, being able to set your equipment and be able to tattoo in front of a window and be able to look out that window and just periodically stop and just look at the view, view at the skyscrapers, look at the Texas outline pool, and it's just amazing just being able to do that. So I love throwing tattoo parties. It's the best. The best thing to do is when you throw a tattoo party, you make sure you start tattooing early. So by the time that you're almost done, people start showing up. And then by the time that you're done, people are barely getting drunk, so they can actually look at your tattoo, and then you're done, and then you get to party. Because the thing is if you start tattooing when people are coming, you're going to be upset because you're not going to be at that party. So, yeah. Well, I'm really into the Astros. I love the Astros. I've been liking the Astros for a while. And I was really honored to be able to tattoo the Astros pitcher. I tattooed Francis Mantis.
Is that the which baseball is, card?
Yeah. Right, so this is a Francis Mantis.
A little bit closer. Okay.
Cool. Nice. So yeah, I was able to tattoo Francis Mantis, and he's a pitcher for the Houston Astros, and it was crazy because like it's a real big honor for him to be able to bring me these cards. I didn't buy these cards. He actually brought them to me himself. A lot of my clients, when I first tattoo them, I try to be respectful, and I try not to tag them or try to show off that I'm tattooing the person. So what I usually try to do is I usually wait about like a week or so before I post it, just to kind of give them some time. I want to give a shout out to Tribes and Culture, Garush Media. You spell it GARUSHIA Media. It's hard to pronounce. Shout out to them for this interviewing me with the Grinch. My name is Ivan Stacks. You could only find me on social media. I'm more of a private artist, so if you look for Ivan Stacks, Stacks with a S, you might find me, you might not. But hit me up if you can. Shout out to my mom. I love you. Love my mom. Always love your mom. And to everybody suffering with breast cancer and or has family that has been going through breast cancer or anything like that, we're all here for you. Once we go through this, your mom becomes my mom, everybody's mom, and to the breast cancer, all the breast cancer survivors and fighters, I love y'all, and thanks for everything.